Hi, I am Dr. Selvaraj, your surgical educator from Malaysia. Welcome back to my series of surgical teaching videocasts. These are meant mainly for undergraduate medical students doing the surgical clerkship rotation. I promise you will become competent in clinical problem solving and surgical decision making if you are going to watch these videos over and over again. Today in this episode, I am going to talk one of the epigastric lumps, that is gastric carcinoma. So after watching this presentation, all of you should be able to understand the various causes for epigastric lumps, the epidemiology, risk factors, pathology, classifications, clinical features, investigation, staging and treatment, and prognosis of gastric carcinoma. Of course, I have included a mind map and a treatment algorithm for gastric carcinoma. So what are the various causes for lump in the epigastric region? They are epigastric or omental hernia, pancreatic tumor that includes pancreatic cyst including the pseudocyst, gastric carcinoma, that is what I am going to discuss in this episode, GIST, this is also carcinoma of the stomach, but this is GIST, it can occur anywhere actually. This is gastrointestinal stromal tumors, not only in the stomach, this can occur anywhere in the intestine. And AAA, that is abdominal aortic aneurysm, retroperitoneal sarcoma, and hepatomegaly. These are various causes for the epigastric lumps. So you have to differentiate gastric carcinoma from all other causes. Coming to the epidemiology, gastric carcinoma comprises 95% of all gastric tumors, that is the adenocarcinoma. The fourth most common GI malignancy worldwide. This is the second cause of cancer mortality behind lung cancer. Approximately 25,000 cases reported in US in 2015. 70% of the patients are older than 50 years, peak in 7th decade of life. Male to female ratio is 2:1. The greatest incidence is in Japan, 80 times greater than in US. 65% of these gastric cancers in US present at an advanced stage, either T3 or T4. Coming to the risk factors, number one is the environmental factors like the diet rich in salt, smoked diet or poorly preserved foods, nitrates and nitrosamines, then smoking, low socioeconomic status, occupational hazard like those who are working in metal, rubber, wood and asbestos industries are more prone to develop gastric carcinoma. Genetic factors, 10% of gastric cancers are familial or inherited and 90% are sporadic. Syndromes associated with gastric carcinoma are BRCA1, BRCA2, hereditary non-polyposis, colorectal cancer, familial adenomatous polyposis, Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, and Lee-Ferriman syndrome. And it is also associated with blood group A is more prone to develop gastric carcinoma. Ethnicity, it is common in Asians, Native and African Americans, Latinos versus the whites. Among whites, it's not very common. Coming to the infectious factors, It could be either H. pylori or Epstein-Barr virus. The H. pylori, 6 to 8 times increased risk, and it is common in distal cancer, not in the proximal one. Other factors are chronic atrophic gastritis, which is usually produced by pernicious anemia or Menetrier's disease. Gastric polyps, that is, risk of malignancy is directly increased with the increased size of these polyps and the degree of the dysplasia in these polyps. Reflex gastritis, that is happening after subtotal gastrectomy, is also a risk factor to develop gastric carcinoma, and this risk is more in Bilrath 2 than in the Bilrath 1 reconstruction. Coming to the pathology, what are the various sites in the stomach and their frequency? In cardiac end of the stomach and in the greater curvature, the percentage is 25%. In fundus of the stomach and in the lesser curvature, it is only 5%. Whereas in the pyloric antrum, the incidence is 40%. Coming to the histological types, it could be either adenocarcinoma, squamous carcinoma, adenosquamous, lymphoma or leiomyosarcoma. Spread could be either local by local infiltration, hematogenous to liver, lung or brain, transloamic to the ovary, that is called Krukenberg's tumor, or the spread could be lymphatic. The lymphatic spread, which is going to the axillary node, is called iris nodes. If it is going to the left supraclavicular node, that is called Virchow's node, and this is Trasius sign. If it is going to the umbilical skin, that is called Sister Mary Joseph nodes. Actually, this is not a lymph node. This is secondary in the umbilical skin only. This is not a lymph node enlargement. This is Sister Mary Joseph nodes. And if the lymphatic secondaries, if they are going to the ovaries, that is called Krukenberg's tumor. Either it can reach it through the lymphatics or transloamic. This is Krukenberg's tumor, and it is more common in premenstrual ovary, not in postmenopausal ovary. And it can go in men, it can get deposited in the rectovesical pouch, which is known as Blummer's self. Macroscopic, and if it is early stage, the classification is called Japanese classification. This is what you are seeing here. Okay, this is type 1 is protruding. This is the tumor. Okay, it is just protruding tumor. And the type 2 is just superficial. And 2A is slightly raised. You are seeing it. It is slightly raised, 2A. Whereas 2B is flat with the surface, whereas 2C is slightly depressed. You can see this is 2A, which is slightly raised, and 2B is flat, and 2C is slightly depressed. Okay, and the type 3 is excavating. You can see a big depression there. This is excavating tumor. So the type 1 and type 2A and 2B has got good prognosis. Whereas the depressed ones, the slightly depressed and the excavating one, has got very bad prognosis. Coming to the macroscopic but advanced carcinoma, the classification is called Bormann's classification. So it is A, B, C, D. A type is polypoidal form. You are seeing a polypoidal growth. B is, it is also polypoidal, but it is ulcerated. You are seeing an ulcer there. And C is, this is infiltrating. And, okay, this is also slightly ulcer, and it is infiltrating. And D is diffusely infiltrating. See, there is no more ulcer. It is just infiltrating. And this one is known as the linitis plastica or leather bottle stomach. That is this diffuse infiltrating variety. coming to the microscopic, I mean, classification, that is called Lauren-Jarvi classification, which, this is the Lauren-Jarvi classification. This is divided into intestinal variety, that is the classical one, and the diffuse variety, which is atypical. The diffuse variety is nothing but the linitis plastica. The intestinal variety is the most common in male and elderly patient. This is more common, the diffuse variety is more common in female, and it is common in younger age group. Intestinal variety, the most common site is the distal part of the stomach. In diffuse variety, the most common site is in either in the fundus or in the proximal part of the stomach. Environmental risk factors are more in intestinal variety, whereas familial risk factors are more in diffuse variety. Well-defined gland formation in intestinal variety, poor gland formation, that is the signet ring variety, is more common in the diffuse variety. Hematogenous spread is more common in intestinal variety, whereas the lymphatic or transmural spread is very common in diffuse variety. It is associated with APC gene mutation, the intestinal variety, whereas in diffuse variety, there is decreased E-cadherin. This is the pathology. This is always intestinal variety is epidemic, whereas diffuse variety is common in endemic. So this is the one tabular column. This is another one. I told you the intestinal variety is common in elderly people, those who are more than 50 years, whereas the diffuse variety is common in younger age group, that is those who are younger than 50 years. Incidence is 60% to 70% intestinal variety, whereas diffuse variety is only 30% to 40%. This is associated with in high-risk countries like Japan, it's very common. In low-risk countries, diffuse variety is common. Prognosis is very good in intestinal. Comparing this one, this is prognosis is good, intestinal variety compared to the diffuse variety. Origin is the gastric glands with intestinal metaplasia, whereas in diffuse variety, this is a de novo in the glands. Graves pathology, it is expansile or mass-like, whereas infiltrative, it is ulcerative. You can see that this one. Microscopically, it is the intestinal one is well differentiated, glands are present, whereas in diffuse variety, it is poorly differentiated. The glands are absent here. Mucin is present in apical vacuolation and gland lumen. Whereas here in the diffuse variety, it is signet ring cells are present. This is associated usually with intestinal variety H. pylori. Whereas diffuse variety is associated either with Epstein-Barr virus, and it is hereditary also. Coming to the clinical features that comprises both symptoms and signs. So what are the symptoms? Often produces no specific symptom when it is very superficial, and in this stage it is potentially curable. Up to 50% of patients may have non-specific GI complaints like dyspepsia. Other symptoms include abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, early satiety with bulky tumors, dysphagia if the tumor is in the GE junction, hematemesis and melena if it is a fungating or ulcerative growth. Many of these patients, especially if they are elderly patients, those who are having anemia, anorexia and asthenia, then you have to suspect gastric carcinoma. So it is more common with those who are having blood group A. Proximal tumors, that is tumor around the cardiac end of the stomach, usually they present with symptom of dysphagia or achalasia like symptom. Whereas the distal tumors, usually they have either dyspepsia, or if it is a big tumor obstructing the pylorus, the patient may present with gastric outlet obstruction. So what are the signs? Because these signs are unhelpful in early gastric cancer, because there won't be any sign at all if it is very early cancer involving only the mucosa. If it is an advanced case, okay, you can feel the abdominal mass in the epigastric region. Patient will be cachexic, bowel obstruction, some of them in advanced case with ascites, hepatomegaly because of secondaries in the liver, and lower extremity edema, that is pedal edema. These are signs of advanced disease. If it is distant metastasis, the classical finding, Krukenberg's tumor is secondary in the ovaries, either by transcelomic spread or lymphatic spread. Iris nodes means secondary spread to the nodes in the axilla. Sister Mary Joseph nodules is secondary deposit in the umbilical skin. Blemus self is rectovesical pouch secondaries in male patients. Virchow's node is left supraclavicular node involvement. If the patient is having antral tumor, they may present with gastric outlet obstruction. In these patients, you can elicit what is called succession splash. That also will be positive. The gold standard investigation to make a diagnosis in a suspected case of gastric carcinoma is, of course, you should do an upper GI endoscope or OGD, and you have to take a biopsy. What are the endoscopic diagnostic criteria? There are no typical features. In some cases, the mucosa appears almost normal. In others, it appears gastritic with patchy erythema and a bumpy surface. Ulceration could be superficial or deep, with or without raised edges. And these ulcerations are usually multiple and bizarre in nature. Sometime, okay, there may be a polypoidal growth. Location is, it can occur anywhere in the stomach, but I have already told you the various sites, with predilection for the more common in gastric body, and that too in the antrum, it is 40%. So here you are seeing various endoscopic pictures of gastric carcinoma in various sites. This picture, you are seeing a gastric carcinoma in the G junction area or cardiac end of the stomach. Here you are seeing a polypoidal growth in the fundus of the stomach, and which is, you can see it is bleeding already. Here you are seeing the ulceroproliferative growth in the greater curvature, where the incidence is 25%. Here you are seeing a polypoidal growth in the antrum of the stomach, where the incidence is 40% here. Another very important investigation for gastric carcinoma is the endoscopic ultrasound. Endoscopic ultrasound is the best investigation to stage any GI tumors, not only gastric carcinoma, even in esophagus, small bowel, large bowel, even in anal canal, up to the anal opening. Wherever there is a tumor in GI tract, this is the best investigation to precisely stage the tumor. This is endoscopic ultrasound. So five layers of the gastric wall may be identified. Here you are seeing, this is the serosa, and then the lamina propria, submucosa, and then you are seeing the mucosa, everything you can see, and you can precisely, you can make out the level of invasion of the gastric, the carcinoma. And apart from precisely knowing the depth of invasion of this tumor, you can also pick up the enlarged lymph nodes with this I mean, investigation. You are seeing here, you are seeing the mass. Precisely, you will be knowing up to which layer it is involving in the gastric stomach. So externally, you will be seeing this a small ulcer. This is a gastric carcinoma. Here it is a diffuse ulcer. Okay, you have to do this endoscopic ultrasound to precisely stage this type of lesion in the stomach. The another important investigation is contrast enhanced CT scan. So gastric wall thickening associated with carcinoma of any reasonable size can be easily detected by the CECT, but it lacks sensitivity in detecting smaller lesion. Very small lesion you may not be able to pick up. Here you are seeing they have given a oral contrast already. You are seeing this is the tumor. This is the tumor you are seeing in the stomach. Less accurate in T staging than endoluminal ultrasound. If you want to do the T staging, then endoluminal or endoscopic ultrasound is the best investigation. I told you, for staging, endoscopic ultrasound is the best investigation. Lymph node enlargement also you can detect by doing the CECT. The other investigation modality is PET scan, that is CT also. You can join CT with the PET scan. Now you can do CT PET scan. This is very important investigation. PET is a functional imaging technique which relies on the uptake of a tracer in most cases by metabolically active tumor tissue. The fluorodeoxyglucose is the most commonly used tracer. Increasingly, it is used in preoperative staging of gastroesophageal cancer. So the middle pair of the images show the primary tumor. So these two things, yeah, you are seeing here, this is the primary tumor in the stomach. The two images on the left is showing unsuspected liver metastasis. You are seeing a liver mets here in this picture. Okay, and the two on the right side is showing a left supraclavicular lymph node is palpable here. Here you are seeing the left supraclavicular lymph node. So if you are combining the CT scan with PET scan, you can pick up not only the primary tumor, you can pick up the secondaries also with this modality. But this PET scan is not available in all hospitals. Staging, the AJCC 8th edition staging is the latest staging for gastric carcinoma. I request my viewers to pause the video and read this TNM staging, and the stage is divided into Stage 1, Stage 2A, 2B, Stage 3, Stage 4A and 4B. Please pause the video and read all these details. Coming to the treatment, the classification of final resection with respect to the final pathology. If it is R0, that means there is no residual tumor after surgery or after resection. If we are telling R1, that means there is microscopic residual disease is there. R2 means gross residual disease is there in the body. Curative resection means you should give a macroscopic margin of at least 5 to 6 centimeter clearance. You should give together with adequate lymphadenectomy. Tumors in the proximal third of the stomach, usually we should do total gastrectomy with reconstruction. Usually we do Roux-en-Y esophagojejunostomy, that is the reconstruction of choice. Perform esophagogastrectomy for tumors in the gastroesophageal junction, then you have to do esophagogastrectomy. For tumors in the middle or distal third of the stomach, we should do distal subtotal gastrectomy, which is associated with improved quality of life over the total gastrectomy and identical survival outcomes. A 5 cm for this to be done, the subtotal gastrectomy, 5 cm margin should be available in the proximal stomach. Then only you will be able to do the subtotal gastrectomy. If you are unable to get 5 cm proximal margin in the stomach, then you have to do only total gastrectomy. So the reconstruction after the subtotal gastrectomy, you can do either Billroth 1. For that, you need enough stomach for tension-free anastomosis for Billroth 1, because you will be joining the stomach with duodenum. For Billroth 2, it is single anastomosis associated with increased bile reflux, and patient may go for Barrett's esophagus, marginal ulcers, and duodenal stump leaks. All these are because in Billroth 2, actually we are doing gastrojejunostomy, and we will be closing the duodenal stump also. So the problem of duodenal stump leak also is there in Billroth 2. And Roux-en-Y anastomosis, if you couldn't do the Billroth 1, then you can go for Roux-en-Y gastrojejunostomy also you can do. N-block resection along with the total gastrectomy, you can resect spleen, liver, transverse colon, and even the pancreas. It may be required for locally advanced tumors or locally infiltrating tumors. Then you have to do what is called the N-block resection of the adjacent organs. That also you have to do. Lymphadenectomy, that is very important for all radical surgery. It is not just total gastrectomy. Total gastrectomy is radical total gastrectomy. That means whenever we are saying radical means, you have to give enough, lymph node removal also you must do. So minimum 15 lymph nodes required for adequate staging purpose. Benefits are, it is better for staging, improved loco-regional control, and the questionable survival benefit. Nomenclature for extent of resection, D1 means omental and perigastric lymph nodes are excised. Extended D1 means omental and perigastric lymph nodes plus lymph nodes along the left gastric artery, common hepatic artery, and celiac axis. D2 means extended D1 plus distal pancreatectomy and splenectomy to harvest peripancreatic and perisplenic nodes. This is what is called D2 clearance. So palliative surgery also you can do for obstruction or bleeding in patients with unresectable tumors. Most of the palliative surgery is only GI bypass, just gastrojejunostomy, for patients who cannot tolerate a laparotomy and are not candidates for gastric resection. You can just do a GI bypass quickly. Endoscopic mucosal resection we have to do for early gastric carcinoma. This is called EMR, endoscopic mucosal resection, limited to experienced centers only. Not all centers are having this expertise to do this endoscopic mucosal resection. Incidence of lymph node metastasis in early gastric cancer is less than 10%. You have to do a close follow-up after this EMR. Indications are non-ulcerated tumors, ulcerated tumors less than 3 cm, any tumor smaller than 3 cm or less than 0.1 mm invasion into the submucosa. Contraindication, you shouldn't do it in diffuse tumors, deep submucosal invasion, that is more than 0.5 mm, you should not do the endoscopic mucosal resection. Coming to neoadjuvant and adjuvant therapy, perioperative chemotherapy you can give. 3 cycles of pre-op chemotherapy you have to give, then you should do surgery, which should be followed by 3 more additional cycles of chemotherapy. This is magic regimen you can use, that is epirubicin, cisplatin, and infused fluorouracil also, 5-fluorouracil. The 5-year survival rate is 36% versus 23% if it is surgery alone. If you are combining this perioperative chemotherapy before and after surgery, then the survival rate is 36%. But if you are doing only surgery, the survival rate is only 23%. The adjuvant chemo radiation, that is, adjuvant means you have to give both chemo and radiotherapy after surgery. Post-operatively, you can give 5-fluorouracil and leucovorin with 45 gray radiation also you can give. Overall, 5-year survival rate is 43% versus 28 in surgery alone in this group. Adjuvant chemotherapy alone also you can give 6 months of post-operative chemotherapy, especially capecitabine and oxaliplatin. These are the chemotherapeutic agents you can give for 6 months alone after surgery only. Improved 5-year survival and recurrence rate over surgery alone in this group. The treatment, you can divide it as curative treatment and palliative treatment. The curative treatment is for stage 1, 2 and 3. The palliative treatment is for stage 4 disease. The stage 1 disease, we can do surgical resection plus regional lymphadenectomy plus or minus adjuvant chemo radiation. Endoscopic mucosal resection is for only for the mucosal disease. Stage 2, here also you can do surgical resection, regional lymphadenectomy plus neoadjuvant chemotherapy plus adjuvant chemo radiation. Stage 3, you can do surgical resection if possible plus regional lymphadenectomy plus neoadjuvant chemotherapy plus adjuvant chemo radiation. For stage 4 disease, you have to do only palliative treatment like palliative chemotherapy, that is ECF regimen, that is epirubicin, cisplatin and 5-fluorouracil. Endoluminal laser therapy also you can do in unresectable tumors, and you can place a stent inside the stomach if it is producing obstruction. Palliative radiotherapy for bleeding or for pain or for obstruction, you can try palliative radiotherapy also. Palliative surgery, that is bypass surgery, for continuous bleeding or for obstruction in this gastric carcinoma, you can use the palliative bypass surgery also. So coming to the prognosis, if it is stage 1 means it could be T1 to 2, N0 and M0. Survival, 5-year survival is 75%. Stage 2, it could be T1 to T4, N1 or N2 and M0. The 5-year survival rate is 35%. Stage 3, it could be T1 to T3, N1 to N3 and M0. Here, the survival rate is 10% only. Stage 4, it is T4, N3 and M1. Survival rate is only 2%. So this prognosis is very important. All of you should know, depending upon what stage, you have to tell the attendants of these patients what is the chance of 5-year survival rate to the patient, you have to tell. But all these patients know, if it is very advanced stage, they will die within 1 year. Yeah. If it is either stage 4 or stage 3, very dismal prognosis. This is the mind map for the gastric carcinoma. This I have prepared. Whatever I have been talking so far for the past, say, half an hour, everything is there in this single page. I have discussed, I have shown it under the risk factors, pathology, clinical features, classification, investigation, staging, treatment. Everything is there in this single page. This you can use for quick revision of all the topics, the mind maps. I have included mind map in all my didactic lectures. So for quick revision, just before the exam, you can use this mind map very effectively. So I request my viewers to pause the video and read all these details carefully. Treatment algorithm. So if it is gastric cancer, of course, you have to elicit a thorough history and physical. The etiology could be nitrate-rich diet or H. pylori infection. The investigation, the gold standard is you have to do an upper GI endoscope, take a biopsy. For acute staging, you should do endoscopic ultrasound. CT scan also you can do to rule out any distant metastasis. And you can also do PET scan, CT PET scan. And the biopsy is the most important thing you have to do. If it is GIST, that is GI stromal tumors, then you have to either observe the tumor or you can do local resection. If it is adenocarcinoma, majority of the tumors, 90% of the tumor are adenocarcinoma only. Immediately after diagnosing, you must do staging. For staging purpose, okay, I told you, you should do endoscopic ultrasound. You can do CT. You can do PET CT also, I told you. PET CT also you can do. You can also do diagnostic laparoscopy to rule out liver secondaries or any peritoneal secondaries. Okay, this is very important. If the patient is already stage 4 disease, metastatic, you have to do only palliative chemotherapy. If it is very early stage, okay, you can do endoscopic mucosal resection. Okay, that you can do. If the endoscopic mucosal resection, you can go for this one. This is this is not early stage. This is in situ carcinoma involving only the mucosa. You can go for endoscopic mucosal resection. Of course, you have to do surveillance follow up these cases after surgery. If it is early cancer, means it's not just confined to mucosa alone. Maybe stage 1 and stage 2. You can do the resection. If it is involving the body and antrum, then if it is intestinal pathology, then you can do what is called distal subtotal gastrectomy. If it is a diffuse variety histology, then you can go for total gastrectomy. Whereas if it is involving the GE junction or proximal part of the stomach, then straight away you can do only total gastrectomy, because if you want to do a subtotal gastrectomy, at least 5 cm of the proximal stomach should be available. Otherwise, you cannot do the subtotal gastrectomy. You can do only total gastrectomy. So that is the thing. So if it is distal gastrectomy or total gastrectomy, you have to do after surgery adjuvant chemotherapy and follow-up in both the cases. Adjuvant chemo and follow-up, you have to do it. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you think that these videos are very useful to you, kindly subscribe to this channel and share these videos in your social media. Kindly click the bell button also to get notified regarding my latest uploads. Thank you once again for watching this video. Let us meet in yet another episode. Until then, bye-bye.